basically start by asking Professor Frank about the role of industry in supporting research in general and supporting research in Africa. Perhaps you could highlight some of the ideas and that Merck started in this area.
I would like to allude a bit longer around that, not too long. We'll leave some time for my colleagues here on the panel. I came to Africa the first time 45 years ago, and I traveled for 2 months to the southern parts, up to Angola, Mozambique, Namibia, and so on. And I thought about it yesterday evening, and the only really vivid memory of those days was women working in the fields, women carrying water, young girls carrying water, women sitting behind market stalls selling fruit and vegetable, women. So sorry, I don't want to offend the African men now, but I couldn't make any sense for me in those days. Then Africa was, or the love for Africa was rekindled in me some 20 years ago, and then I started to come to Africa very regularly, every year 2-3 times. And of course, traveling through many, many different countries by car, really through the rural countryside, was the same. You saw women working hard. And I realized without women, Africa would not function. That's a fact. Yeah? And you like it or not, but that's a fact for me. 20 years ago, there was no mobile phone, no bottled water, nothing. Now we have got that all. You still see women working, but you also see, on the one side, intelligent young Africans coming back to their home countries, taking on responsibility. And you see, of course, the empowerment of women. The first women president, yeah, which is quite an achievement, particularly after this terrible civil war they had. And for us, it became very clear at Merck, we have to do something about it. We have to help, because we are a pharmaceutical company. We are in 66 countries now. So we developed an African strategy, simply to bring to the countries of Africa, and we are now in 12 countries with our own offices, what we can do for the countries. And of course, we started our capacity advancement program, Merck More Than a Mother, and some other programs. And for that, of course, we picked a woman from Africa, Russia. And she is from Egypt, but Egypt is part of Africa. And she's very forceful, and she introduced this program to Africa. And what can we do? Industry, it's got money. I told you we spent 1.7 billion on R&D work alone last year, and we do this every year increasingly because R&D is very, very expensive. And we also want to widen this net to Africa, and of course with a focus on women. Not only, but also particularly on women. And what we can do, we saw Rebecca. She is a good example of what we can do. We can support young, gifted researchers, of course with financial means, because they all have to live somehow, but also, and far more important, of course, with passing on the knowledge we have. And we have got a lot of knowledge and experience gathered in the 340 years of Merck history. And that we want to pass on. So our main task will be, one, to have these programs, the capacity advancement programs, to advance capacity in young researchers, in young nurses, in young doctors as well, on specific diseases like diabetes, which is an area we are active in. And of course, the next step is then to really promote young, gifted scientists to teach them the cutting edge of research. And we do that in our offices and research laboratories in Germany and in America then. And we hope that we can find many more to come. It is always, they have to come forward as well, because how will you pick out of a haystack a needle? It's not that easy. And this needle has to be a gifted needle, because they have to compete with other nations around the world. But the Africans too can do it. We saw two examples. I was just approached by a young man during our coffee break. He did a research on cultural influence of diseases, also sponsored by us last year. So there are many areas industry can do, because industry got the means to do it, and we have to give back. That's for us, it's a family-owned company. You know, Merck owns the company and controls the company. Very close to the heart of myself and of all our family members, the 150 family members, that we want to give back to society. And the best way to do it in society who needs it. And the African society needed more than the German society. It's as simple as that. So I hope we will find many more candidates, which we then can train in our laboratories around the world. We have more than 10,000 scientists. I'm quite sure there's an enormous playing field for every gifted young African woman, and I have to say also men, of course. Yeah? But the emphasis for us is on empowering women, because up to now, they've made Africa work, and I'm quite sure it will continue in the future as well. So that's all I have to say to this at the moment.
Thank you very much.
My second question will go to our ministers of health. The question will be around the science, technology, and innovation strategy for Africa, STISA 2024. And the 2013 Abuja Declaration Special Summit outlined that Africa vision for an African-led health research that reduces the burden of disease. The strategy articulated that in order to achieve this, Africa needs to promote pools of excellence of its human resource across the region. So how can you see with, restricted financial resources, how can we build research capacity, and how can we empower researchers in Africa with the objective to translate this to health solutions at the end, not only research for the sake of research. And we know that there is a lot of important topics. I know that 90% of the research fund goes to HIV and hepatitis and other things, which is infectious diseases. But there is other topics like cancer and infertility and untreated infectious diseases, which is very high prevalence, like emergent cases like Zika and other things when we have Ebola as emergent infectious diseases. So how can we, as a ministers and policymakers, yourself to dedicate this fund to research and make sure that it is already dedicated?
Thank you very much, Russia. First and foremost, before I say what I want to say, can I request the Ugandans in the audience to please stand up for recognition, led by Professor Potasio Caleb. Yes, you can see there's three ladies there. So I want to really state that Uganda, like many other African countries, carries a heavy burden of infectious diseases like TB, malaria, and HIV/AIDS. And of course, we are now seeing as well an increase in another infectious disease, hepatitis B. And the non-communicable diseases are equally rising. But of course, we need, first of all, to salute all the researchers who have enabled us currently to have treatment for these diseases, these infectious diseases. We have treatment for malaria, treatment for TB, and of course, the medication for HIV/AIDS is available. But a lot still needs to be done. As a country, we have, of course, promoted the young scientists. And although not many of our doctors, not many of our scientists actually do engage in research, we've had grants from different partners and, of course, the government of Uganda trying to encourage research. And we have also set up institutions like the Uganda Virus Research Institute. And I'm glad Professor Protasio is here to actually help promote research in that area. And much of what we are proud of in the fight against Ebola and, of course, other viral hemorrhagic fevers is because of that strong institution, the Uganda Virus Research Institute, coupled with the political support and support from other professionals in between. So, of course, as a government also, we have the Uganda Industrial Research Institute. And we must not forget that as Africa, we have potential. We have traditional medicines which we cannot ignore. And as a government, we have the National Chemotherapeutic Research Laboratory, which actually promotes the traditional medicines. And I must state that as we are also coming up with a bill to regulate these traditional herbalists because they come up with all kinds of claims and yet they are not regulated. So in Parliament currently, we have that bill, the Indigenous and Complementary Medicines Bill, which we hope will be passed into law very soon to regulate that sector. As government, we have promoted girls to actually undertake sciences by giving them a little more points at university to bring them at par with the men. We have about 120 doctors qualifying annually from just one university, the oldest university, that is Makerere University. And out of these 120, only 20% are actually women. But you find that, unfortunately, the women that qualify, because of the various tasks that women must undertake in their life, you are a mother, you have to balance work, and sometimes it's also difficult for them to engage in research. So this has, in a way, reduced the number of women researchers, but we've come up with specifically a fund, the SFF, to promote women. It's the Female Scholarship Fund, to actually promote women researchers, and of course, there are also other interventions. But specifically on the side of the human resource, as government, we have endeavored to promote the human resource, specifically in science and technology. Our president is very supportive and encouraging the young people to undertake sciences. And this is also done through motivating them by increasing their salaries. So the president himself has made a pledge of increasing salaries for the scientists at the universities, of course, beginning with the lecturers, and even those that qualify, like the doctors and others. So this, in a way, motivates our young people to undertake sciences as a priority, as a course. But of course, as I did indicate, we are also promoting research through having various grants from different partners, grants from the government of Uganda. And of course, we hope that the various challenges that still exist will be attended to if we promote research in our countries. So we need to commit resources as governments, and also, most importantly, build capacities of individuals and also build capacities of institutions. But this cannot be done without resources. So as governments within Africa, as policymakers, we need to put aside funds, resources to promote research in order to build the capacities of these individuals and institutions. Thank you very much.
Same question goes to Minister of Public Health of Niger. So how would you think that in Niger you can build research capacity specifically in the topics which is emergent at the moment and lacking fund for research like cancer, other emergent cases?
Donc, merci et pour la parole. Permettez-moi d'abord de remercier l'UNESCO et le MERC et qui nous ont permis ou qui ont permis à la République du Niger d'être en tout cas invitée à cette importante conférence qui regroupe des éminents chercheurs de part le monde. Et je remercie également le gouvernement de l'Éthiopie pour l'organisation de cette conférence. Et Merck, qui est quand même qui est une industrie de fabrication de médicaments qui aujourd'hui s'intéresse à la santé des groupes les plus vulnérables. Et j'ai nommé les femmes et les enfants. Vous savez, au Niger, à l'un des taux de fécondité le plus élevé au monde. Quand on a fait la moyenne, chaque femme au Niger a à peu près 7 enfants et demi. Et le taux de croissance a atteint 3,9. Et la plupart de ces femmes sont analphabètes, elles se retrouvent en milieu rural. Et l'analphabétisme, quand même, est un facteur de survenue et de la propagation des maladies. C'est un pays qui a environ 20 000 habitants, 52% de cette population est constituée par les femmes. Donc, la santé de la mère et de l'enfant est une vive préoccupation de nos autorités. Et en l'occurrence, le président, notre président, qui est aussi un chercheur, qui a fait de la santé de la mère et de l'enfant son champ de bataille. Et donc, pour revenir à la question, la recherche sur les systèmes de santé occupe une place primordiale dans les stratégies d'amélioration des prestations des services de santé au Niger. Et c'est ainsi, avec le concours des différents partenaires de proximité, comme l'OMS, l'Organisation mondiale de la santé, l'UNFPA, l'UNICEF, en tout cas, et d'autres partenaires qui appuient le Niger dans l'amélioration de la santé de la population. Plusieurs actions ont été réalisées au sein de mon département ministériel pour améliorer la recherche ou pour redynamiser la recherche. Et donc, entre autres, les actions les plus importantes, il y a eu l'élaboration, la vulgarisation et la mise en œuvre d'un plan stratégique national de la recherche en santé qui va de 2013 à 2020. La deuxième grande stratégie, c'est la création d'un cadre de concertation de la recherche en santé au Niger. Et il y a eu l'élaboration du projet de loi de recherche en santé et son décret d'application. Et cette loi a passé au Conseil du ministre tout récemment, et en Conseil de cabinet, et elle sera transmise au Conseil du ministre pour adoption. Il y a eu la création d'un comité national d'éthique en matière de la recherche en santé et avec son décret, son arrêté d'application. Il y a eu la création d'une ligne budgétaire sur la recherche scientifique et l'innovation, surtout pour améliorer la santé de la reproduction et la santé de l'enfant. Nous avons également eu l'institutionnalisation d'une journée nationale de l'innovation pour la recherche en santé au Niger. Il y a eu la tenue des ateliers de capitalisation des bonnes expériences en recherche en santé, qui est une rencontre de partage et d'échange des acquis en matière de la recherche en santé. Nous avons également eu à former plusieurs cadres du ministère de la Santé et autres secteurs qui interviennent dans le cadre de la santé, puisqu'on évolue et dans ce qu'on appelle le One Health. Tout récemment, à Dakar, il y a eu le sommet sur la santé et l'environnement, et qui a fait suite également au sommet de Marrakech, qui a également touché la santé et le changement climatique, tout ça dans le cadre d'améliorer la santé de la mère et de l'enfant et appuyer les chercheurs. Et tous ces efforts, ont permis de booster la recherche en santé à différents niveaux. Au niveau opérationnel, le niveau opérationnel, c'est les districts et sanitaires. Au niveau régional, c'est les directions régionales. Au niveau des régions, le Niger dispose des 8 régions et nous avons des hôpitaux de référence, des centres hospitaliers universitaires, des centres de recherche comme le centre Sarmex qui est appuyé par l'Institut Pasteur. Plusieurs thèmes de recherche ont été abordés pour améliorer la santé de la mère et de l'enfant. C'est surtout les causes des décès maternels, parce qu'on enregistre au Niger le plus important taux en matière de décès de la mère et de l'enfant. La prise en charge de la tuberculose, du VIH-Sida, du paludisme, les couvertures vaccinales, la malnutrition, la problématique des infections nosocomiales dans les établissements de santé, dans les hôpitaux, du fait de développement des résistances vis-à-vis des antibiotiques, en tout cas par certains germes, qui aujourd'hui posent un sérieux problème de santé au Niger. Il y a l'intégration des soins de santé mentale dans les soins généraux. Il y a la prévalence de la drépanocytose chez les enfants de moins de 5 ans. Donc, tous ces facteurs, en tout cas, toutes ces stratégies vont être mises en œuvre pour améliorer la recherche avec l'appui, effectivement, des partenaires au développement qui appuient le Niger et tout ça, pour améliorer le salaire de la santé de la mère et de l'enfant. Parce qu'un adage de chez nous dit, vous éduquez une femme, c'est comme si vous éduquez une nation. Et on ne peut pas, en tout cas, améliorer la santé de la population sans améliorer la santé de la mère et de l'enfant. Je vous remercie.
My third question will go to Minister Julia. And with Minister Julia, Ministers of Gender and Children and Social Development of Liberia, and also Minister Sara Obindi, Minister of State of Health of Uganda, we have kicked off a very important initiative called Merck More Than a Mother. And it's actually about why we are talking about this, because the main cause of this problem, which is infertility in Africa, is due to untreated infectious diseases and due to lack of research in that department. So infertility is not only a problem of a medical problem, it's a cultural problem as well. And it is very much related to women, because mostly women are the one who have been blamed to be infertile. So it's a very much related to empowering women. And we had dedicated an important session in the summit these 2 days to discuss the relationship between untreated infectious diseases and the high prevalence of infertility in women, and how to fight the stigma of infertility and raise awareness about male infertility. Important. It is important because it's one couple every four couples of in Africa are suffering from infertility, while 85% and more can be prevented because it's due to untreated infectious diseases. So we have a very devastated problem, and you will see the video now, you will see why it's devastated, because it's a culture, it is a medical problem, it's a lot of other angles of this issue, and it can be prevented, and research can very much help in that.
Women by nature are researchers. Before I get to the video you just saw, during the Ebola crisis in Liberia, it took a medical student to think quick, and she was able to save her mom, her dad, and herself. She heard about the Ebola disease, the outbreak, and she was in one of our political subdivisions. She was not in the capital city. And her mom called her and said, there's something happening to your dad and myself. You need to come, leave the campus and come home so you can help us. And she asked her mom, what is happening? She said, I can't explain it. It seems like malaria. It looked like typhoid, but something is wrong. And so she rushed home. When she got home, before she entered the door, she saw some used plastic bags. She took the plastic bags because there were no gloves. She wrapped them around her hands. She wrapped them around her feet. And then she put one over her head. And she went in and she saw her mom and her dad passing out blood, running stool. And she said, you have the Ebola disease. And they couldn't understand what she was talking about. But she was able to think very quick. And then she called for an ambulance. She called the hospital. And because of her quick intervention, she was able to save her mom and her dad and herself. Today, she at Johns Hopkins University researching the type of Ebola virus that hit the Mana River region. We're told that there are various kinds of Ebola. So she's researching on that particular type. So I'm saying this to say, thanks to Merck and UNESCO for partnering with countries and empowering women in research. I want to congratulate all of the women in this room today who are standing toe to toe with their male counterparts and wanting to go into the field of research. By empowering women, you are empowering your community, you are empowering your country, you are empowering the world at large. It is often said that if you want something said, ask a man. But if you want something done, ask a woman. So let us continue to empower the women so that we can have more women researchers. It is no mistake that the SDGs, goal 3, goal 4, and Co5 are all interlinked. Health, education, and gender equality. So if we look at those three goals, UNESCO and Merck, we are heading in the right directions. As we commemorate the 16 days of activism, you saw Jacqueline in this video. There are a lot of Jacquelines in your community. There are a lot of Jacquelines in your country. This needs to stop. And how can it stop? From the government perspective, it's developing policies that will help people like Jacqueline have access to medical attention and research why these things are happening. Most time we blame it on culture because we're from Africa. Everything is culture and tradition. You heard my colleague from Uganda. What stopped a lot of women from going into the medical field of research or science? Because not only that, they have to deal with the being a mother or being a woman. You know, my grandmother used to say that a woman should be seen and not heard. It's about time that we pass that. We need to be heard. We need to raise our voices. We need to be with our male counterpart. And we are asking our male counterpart to help us, encourage us. We are saying side by side. It's a slogan that we use. You cannot fly a plane with one wing. You need both wings. So you need both the male and the female to be able to move that plane. Infertility in Africa is a big, big problem. More than a mother is here to help us solve some of those problems. We are now calling on all of you in this room who are going to be the next researcher. I don't see any from Liberia, but I hope that I'm going to go back now and work with my colleague at the Ministry of Health, the Ministry of Education, and identifying those young women and young men who want to go into the field of researching, and so that I can encourage them to take full advantage of the opportunity. But we also want to say that please don't just, after watching that video, there are more videos than that, but we all can go back and make a difference in their lives. We can join Merck More Than a Mother and make a difference in the lives of these young women, these young men, who don't know that they do have a problem. So as you research tuberculosis, AIDS, TB, malaria, but also research infertility. Why is it happening? Why are we putting the blame on the wrong person, on the woman and not on the man? It's both, male and female. So we need to come up with solutions in resolving this. And the stigmatization must not just be on the woman. And that's why More Than a Mother came in about, to help these women, empower them in the community, so they too can be healthy citizens to contribute to the community. But most time, our mothers, if you don't bear a grandchild for them, they tell you that something is wrong with you. So to our mothers, our fathers, please allow your daughters to go to school. Please allow your sons to appreciate the role that their sisters and aunties have to play in society. If you educate the woman, you educate your community, you educate your country, you educate the world at large. Thanks to Merck More Than a Mother, thanks to UNESCO, and let's continue to stress that Co3, Co4, and Co5 cannot be achieved if they don't go hand in hand. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Minister Julia. I just wanted to focus on, perhaps want to involve also the Minister of Equatorial Guinea here, because you mentioned the importance of, the education, of educating a woman. But I also want to put another spin on this, of educating the girl, the young girl. And I wanted to know from some of the panelists here about the programs that you have in your countries on STEM education, science, technology, engineering, and mathematics. Because We hear a lot of days, you know, times in international arena, in the UN General Assembly, that in order to move this agenda of research, we have to start at the base, at the school, at the school level. So I wanted to know, perhaps from Minister Jesus to start with, some of the programs that you have in Equatorial Guinea on educating girls in science and technology and engineering. And what are the sort of, what are the programs that you have in the pipeline to support STEM education? And whether you have some successful projects or examples where the educated girl have gone to get into to research, to improve the research milieu of your country. Perhaps you can shed light, and I would also ask some of the ministers here to also talk about this topic, because it's part of the base of what we're talking about.
Seguidamente, quería, antes de contestar a su pregunta, hacer una breve introducción de mi presencia aquí, en gratitud a la invitación que se nos ha cursado.
Donc avant de répondre à la question, je voudrais faire une brève introduction et remercier par rapport à l'opportunité de cette invitation qui a été faite.
Nos resulta agradable estar en Addis Abeba.
Nous sommes très heureux d'être ici à Addis Abeba.
Una ciudad histórica.
Qui est une ville historique.
Que ha venido viviendo los avatares del continente africano.
Dans lequel on a tous les avatars du continent africain.
Et
où on organise des événements très très importants.
Esta circunstancia me permite traerles los cálidos y fraternales saludos del pueblo de Guinea Ecuatorial.
Donc je transmets ici les salutations chaleureuses du peuple équato-guinéen.
Y felicitaciones por ver cómo África se organiza.
Et aussi, il se félicite de voir comment l'Afrique s'organise.
Toma conciencia de sí.
L'Afrique prend conscience d'elle-même.
Y emprende iniciativas que dibujan un futuro mejor para sus hijos.
Et elle entreprend des initiatives qui dessinent un avenir meilleur pour le continent.
Y es un motivo de orgullo.
Donc c'est un motif de grande fierté pour la Guinée
équatoriale.
Donc pour la Guinée équatoriale qui partage les mêmes aspirations
et
qui démontre sa solidarité avec tous les pays du monde en général
et
en particulier avec les pays d'Afrique.
Hemos acogido con satisfacción la invitación que nos ha sido cursada.
Donc nous avons accueilli avec satisfaction cette invitation que nous avons reçue.
Y estamos aquí para apostar nuestra pequeña contribución.
Et nous sommes ici pour apporter notre petite contribution.
Al desarrollo exitoso de esta segunda edición de esta cumbre.
Au succès de ce sommet.
Históricamente sabemos que África es uno de los continentes que han contribuido al desarrollo de la ciencia.
Donc, sur le plan historique, nous savons que l'Afrique a contribué au développement de la science et que l'Afrique a contribué beaucoup pour le développement de l'humanité. Et donc, c'est un potentiel et un bagage que l'Afrique doit récupérer
para responder adecuadamente a los retos del desarrollo.
Pour pouvoir répondre de façon adéquate aux défis du développement.
Tanto desde la dimensión cultural,
aussi bien sur le plan culturel
como la técnica y científica.
Que sur le plan technique et scientifique.
Por tanto, Guinea Ecuatorial felicita esta iniciativa.
Donc la Guinée équatoriale se félicite pour cette initiative
y desea un exitoso resultado de los trabajos de esta cumbre.
Et souhaite plein succès aux travaux de ces sommets.
Bien, a nivel de la pregunta que me ha sido formulada.
Donc en ce qui concerne la question qui m'a été posée.
Decir al auditorio que el sistema educativo de la República de Guinea Ecuatorial es non discriminatorio e incluyente.
Donc je voudrais dire que le système éducatif de Guinée équatoriale ne pratique pas de discrimination, mais que c'est un système inclusif.
Por lo tanto, no hay discriminación de sexo.
Nous n'avons pas de distinction de sexe,
de religion,
de
raza,
ni de race.
Por esto, la paridad de participación entre chicos y chicas en nuestro sistema educativo es al 100%.
Donc la participation des jeunes filles, des filles et des garçons est de 100% pour ce qui est de l'école.
Hemos emprendido una reforma curricular.
Donc, nous avons entrepris une réforme au niveau de la formation.
Para deshacernos de un sistema que ponía en una aula a mujeres y en otra aula a hombres.
Pour sortir d'un système qui faisait en sorte qu'on avait des classes spécifiques pour les filles et d'autres pour les garçons.
Y hemos encontrado que las chicas tienen el mismo talento, las mismas capacidades, incluso muchas veces más que los chicos.
Et on a bien remarqué que les filles avaient parfois plus de compétences, plus d'intelligence que les garçons.
Por tanto, el Ministerio de Educación, que es parte del gobierno,
le ministère de l'éducation, qui est bien entendu au sein du gouvernement,
asume la política del gobierno hacia el empoderamiento de la mujer.
Donc la politique du gouvernement est là pour fortifier, pour redonner du pouvoir aux femmes.
Por tanto, las dificultades que pueden encontrar las chicas en determinadas matemáticas, como lo ha puntualizado usted, en el sistema no pueden tener como referencia la discriminación.
Donc les difficultés que peuvent rencontrer les jeunes filles dans des secteurs de sciences comme les mathématiques ou autres, cela n'aura pas pour origine la discrimination.
Creo que la mayor parte de este auditorio es docente.
Et donc je pense bien que la majeure partie des personnes ici sont des enseignants, des chercheurs.
Y todos sabemos que tanto para hombres que para mujeres hay determinadas asignaturas que no son fáciles de digerir.
Donc, on sait très bien que parfois, pour les femmes comme des hommes, il y a des matières, il y a des filières qu'on va facilement aborder.
Y eso le ocurre a las matemáticas, a la física, a la química. En el sistema hemos introducido otra asignatura, que es la tecnología, que como lo decíamos en la universidad, es un ladrillo.
Donc on a des matières comme les sciences, les mathématiques, la chimie, la technologie qu'on a inclus et pour encourager aussi les femmes à s'intégrer.
Pero hemos encontrado que después de poner en pie las políticas que persiguen la igualdad entre hombres y mujeres, hay muchas chicas que están en mejores condiciones para superar esas materias que los chicos.
Donc on a remarqué effectivement que ces matières qu'on pensait que les femmes ne pouvaient pas véritablement réussir, mais on a remarqué que les filles, les femmes avaient beaucoup plus de capacité à réussir dans ces domaines.
El problema que puede afectar principalmente a las chicas en nuestro sistema educativo, y creo que el nuestro no es excluyente, creo que esto le pasaría a la mayor parte de los países africanos, son los elementos exógenos que hacen difícil la culminación de determinados ciclos de enseñanza para las mujeres, en el sentido de que cuando empiezan el preescolar y llegan a primaria, cuando empiezan la secundaria, se encuentran con que muchas veces ya son tienen otras, digamos, apetencias corporales, tienen elementos exógenos al sistema educativo que las acosa. La pobreza es una de esas condicionantes y entre la primaria, entre el término.
Alors donc les femmes, les jeunes filles rencontrent des problèmes parfois à un certain niveau qui sont exogènes aux questions éducatives. Donc lorsqu'elles quittent le primaire et arrivent au secondaire, c'est parfois d'autres orientations qui n'ont pas de rapport avec l'école qui sont parfois à l'origine de certaines difficultés qu'elles rencontrent. Donc il y a aussi le problème de la pauvreté.
De telle sorte que muchas empiezan a embarazarse en una temprana edad.
Donc beaucoup tombent enceintes très jeunes au niveau du collège.
Como sabemos y como lo ha dicho la ministra de Liberia, ¿no? Las consecuencias vienen inmediatamente.
Donc comme l'a dit la ministre du Liberia, donc on sait que les jeunes femmes à ce moment-là, il y a des conséquences lorsqu'on tombe enceinte très jeune, il y a beaucoup de conséquences qui vont suivre.
A mí me conmocionó las imágenes que acabamos de ver.
J'ai été très ému par la vidéo que nous venons de suivre concernant cette femme.
Que a todos nos han conmocionado y que creo que debemos lanzar desde aquí un grito de que ojalá ella sea la última.
Donc on devrait depuis ici faire un appel, lancer un cri parce que on aimerait que ce soit vraiment la dernière fois qu'on voit ce genre de choses.
Entonces, esas dificultades que hacen que las chicas lleguen como empiezan en pie de igualdad con los chicos a la universidad es precisamente lo que les acabo de comentar. Cuando se embarazan ya saben que el embarazo es no solamente un riesgo, sino que si la matrícula en un aula de clase o en un centro escolar es una. Esas dificultades que hacen que las chicas lleguen como empiezan en pie de igualdad con los chicos a la universidad es precisamente lo que les acabo de comentar. Cuando se embarazan ya saben que el embarazo es no solamente un riesgo, sino que si la matrícula, cuando los padres empiezan a costear las
politics have to encourage the high quality people who go abroad to learn about research and to conduct research to come back to the countries of their origin and help there to build up research capacity. Unfortunately, we know that all, yeah, that's a problem. They then prefer to stay where they are because they find an ideal environment for their work. They are passionate about research, and if you have as a gifted researcher, a top quality laboratory at hand, yeah, it is difficult to convince this person to come back to a university which is not that well funded, which can't afford all this modern equipment. So I don't want to kick the ball back into the politics court, but I think it has to be a closer cooperation between politics, yeah, the ministries, to support universities, to enable young gifted researcher to continue the research they've started abroad, then also in their home countries. So it's never the one or the others. It's always a joint effort. And I think we have to work on that from all sides. We are not there yet, I agree with you entirely. And if you look around, I think I mentioned Rebecca already. She's a good example. So I very much hope she will return to her native country, Nigeria. But maybe if she wants to stay in Germany or wants to move to America, she will have opportunities. So it's difficult to convince a young girl not to take on these opportunities. So it's a bit of a vicious circle, and I think policy, in particular the policy makers, have to try to break through this vicious circle. It's not encouraging, but I think all the answer I have at the moment.
There is this important thing that I want to ask our policy makers, the decision makers, because in front of my eyes, I can see many government officials, and I know there are many laws in Africa, but the implementation and the enforcement of these laws is not effective. So what are you planning, or do you need some help from MEC? What is your plan, really, to counterattack this thing, because you see a very talented woman who can do great science, even more than Marie Curie, but she, the one who is supposed to sign her recommendation wants something in return. And this is a complete bottleneck for their empowerment, and we need you guys to do something about it. Thank you.
I think I mentioned what my government is doing in regard to promoting women researchers. There are various grants that I did mention. I mentioned the Female Scholarship Foundation. We also have the Women Scientists Career Development Program, which is really targeting the women researchers, and that may, in a way, help address the challenge that my brother there talked about sexual harassment. And it's a man raising this issue on sexual harassment, not the women. Thank you for that. But I really want to state that by the time somebody is a researcher, you are fairly empowered. You've gone through some level of education. Unlike somebody who is just at maybe senior six level or just going to university. So the women must speak out. If there are cases of sexual harassment, women need to speak out. We already have a law, another law introduced in Parliament just last week, the Sexual Offences Bill. So in my country, this is something that we hope to address. But allow me also to state that my government took a deliberate step to promote science in country. The government does pay tuition fees for students who excel, but also those, because the numbers are big, they cannot take on everybody. So what the government has done is to put aside a loan scheme to support these students who are going to do science subjects, specifically science subjects. So with this loan scheme, you go and study. When you complete, once you get a job, then you're able to pay the government in installments until you complete. But allow me to say something about that very sad video that we actually saw, we all watched, about infertility. Infertility, as you all know, is a shared responsibility. And it's really a shame if the men turn on their female, on their wives, and blame them for being infertile. In my country, we know that services, the fertility care services available, have been in the private sector, and all based within the capital city. So the government of Uganda is currently constructing a state-of-the-art women's hospital. It will be a public facility, and we really want to thank Mark. Mark, for picking on this subject of infertility. It has existed since man was created, but no one had actually paid attention to it. And it's, you know, individuals suffering on their own. So Mark, thank you very much. When she, Rasha, approached me, it took me time, and I was saying, we're talking about family planning and all this. Now, infertility again. But later, she kept insisting, and we sat, she took me through, and I really saw how important this subject is. And in my country, we had to launch a campaign against infertility, and I'm actually Mark's ambassador for this campaign against infertility in my country. And what we are really doing is to speak to women, speak to men, and tell them that please first go to the health facilities. You can get assistance from the health facilities. And of course, this state-of-the-art women's hospital that is being constructed will be completed by about April next year. And we want to thank Mark for training. Of course, they pledge to train 5 embryologists. We don't have any of them in the public health facilities. So these embryologists will definitely be taken up and employed, and will be working at the women's hospital. Thank you very much, Mark. And of course, the IVF services and the assisted reproductive technology will be provided at this state-of-the-art women's hospital at a fairly reduced price. Because in the private sector, you need to find maybe about $5,000 or so, which the common women cannot afford. So in the public facility, we hope that this will be much, much more cheaper. Thank you very much, Mark, and thank you for this research summit. I remember the first summit in Geneva when I attended. Recall I was running for office, campaigning, and I came for the summit and I took off very fast. Thank you for your prayers. I managed to make it back.
Thank you very much, Honorable Minister Opendim. Perhaps we could close with Professor Frank. Remarks, please.
Too much praise for Merck, but thank you very much, Minister. The legacy, what will be the legacy of Merck? Yes, you know, my heart really is burning for Africa for a long time. And we introduced this Africa strategy 5 years ago. And now we are already employing 500 people in 12 countries. We are active in 52 countries. And of course, that's on the commercial side. But far more important for us is the work we do on the corporate social responsibility side. So we introduce Merck More Than a Mother capacity advancement program. We give quite a handful of scholarships to gifted young talented doctors to go to Europe and study and enhance themselves. In India, yeah, but just confirm to Africa. So we are fighting bilharziosis. Yeah? So you don't have to demand for Merck. We do it already. We do it. We have already donated more than 25 million tablets. Don't forget, a child has to take one tablet and it's got rid of this terrible disease. Yeah? And we are committed to do more than 50 million tablets. And by the way, it's also our product. We researched it. We give it free. We manufacture it in Mexico. We ship it to here. And with the help of WHO, we distribute it and the local governments. So we are really heavily committed in improving and helping. We did the mini lab program and so on. There's a lot of things we do. Of course, I very much hope that other companies will follow. That's not in our hands. We can only give an example. And of course, we do the best we can do. And up to now, I must say, again, thank you for your words. It is very gracious. We really feel moved by that, that we can make a difference. But never forget, it takes a long time. Nothing is happening fast. We all wish it would happen fast because our span of life God gave us very short. It takes time to develop. I'm very confident it will develop further and we will have more impact in the years to come.
Thank you very much.